morning once again, ladies and gentlemen, and we're going to have an interesting chat over the next 25 minutes on really women in tech and how we're looking to build the women in tech in the times to come. So it's an important mission for me to see, you know, how we can have more inclusion for women. Particularly, I've seen that there are a lot of women in the tech space who are coders, who are technologists, but we would also like to see a lot of more tech entrepreneurs and essentially a lot more women who are tech investors. You know, I was just listening to the question the lady had said, and it's actually a reality for a lot of us women, because, you know, after doing a job and having kids and a family and, you know, the whole barracuda, it sometimes is tough for us to extend ourselves a little forward and try to do more. But, you know, that is the real opportunity that this country has today and the world has, that we need to extend ourselves and to be able to do more and catapult ourselves to be able to take the best of what the world has to offer. So given the circumstances that exist today, we need to be change makers and we need to be more open-minded in terms of how we see our growth happening and how we see life beyond our families, life beyond our jobs, to be able to fulfill our dreams. Now, for some, it could be to become an entrepreneur, some to be a passive investor, and some, you know, probably as simple as, you know, becoming more financially independent. So therefore, we have to try to achieve the best of it. So we, in fact, got, two powerful women joining us online also today. So I'm just waiting for them to come on the link. They're there? I can't see them. Ms. Rama Devi Lanka, it's wonderful to have you here with us. She's joining us all the way from Hyderabad, and she's part of the government of Telangana, and, you know, as a powerful woman out there, she's helping in the, from the government side to build more women in the tech space, particularly in blockchain and Web3 there. So welcome, ma'am, and thank you for joining us today morning. So the theme that we have over here today is how women in tech can be more empowered, and particularly, you know, given how you are trying to build the tech industry back in Telangana and in India as a whole, where do you see women lack and how they can do more with themselves? If we can give her the mic, please, the volume, please.
Am I audible?
We can hear you, ma'am.
Yeah, but when you're speaking, it's kind of broken to me, you know, I'm not able to...
Ma'am, is this better? Ma'am, can you hear me now?
No, actually the sentences are broken, so I'm not able to make sense of what you're speaking.
Okay, ma'am, I was saying that, you know, how are you helping the women in tech in Telangana to get more women to participate in tech jobs and become tech entrepreneur?
Sorry, no, I'm not able to, you know, understand. I mean, the sentences are kind of broken, so...
Okay, just give me a minute. We will message you the question so that, you know, you can answer it for us. Can you hear me now, ma'am?
Yes.
So we wanted to know, how are you working on helping tech entrepreneurs, women tech entrepreneurs in your state?
Sorry, no, I cannot make sense of the sentence, I'm sorry.
Okay, just give me a minute. Okay, ma'am, we'll just message you the question so that you can answer it from there. We'll just sending it to you over a text message, just for better clarity. So we've also got, in the meantime, as the question comes to you, we've also got Ruchi with us here from ACO, and, you know, she's, yes. So Ruchi is here from ACO, and she's building up, a great insurtech company. And, you know, they have done a lot of work in terms of helping, particularly, you know, Ruchi, my question to you is that both as an entrepreneur, and how are you also empowering more women to make insurance investments, because you know I see women lack it. They just put it on to the man and say, "Tum kar lo." You know, so how do you sort of ensure that more women are participative in getting insurance for themselves, for their families, and how they are more empowered?
Thank you so much. That's a great question. When we actually started the ACO journey in 2016, this was actually the biggest thing on my mind. Because when I told you know, my friends and family that I wanted to start an insurance company, they kind of looked at me with shock, saying, "Tumne khud insurance kharida hai kya life mein?" And that was kind of a jolt. I had actually, to be honest, I was very young at that time. I was about 30 year old, and I had purchased an insurance myself, a health insurance. But honestly, I had no clue about it. I just purchased a health insurance because I knew that it was important to have a safety net apart from your employer's health insurance, just in case something untoward happened. But had I gone through the journey? No, I had just, my banker was HDFC. Yeah, tech problem indeed. So I just relied on someone else, basically an agent, my relationship manager, to get me a financial product. And I realized that was such a wrong way to actually even try and buy a financial product, because I had no understanding. I didn't know what I had purchased. I just knew I had something. So I basically, what it meant was that when time would have come to actually utilize it, I would have probably not even realized, you know, what it entailed. So I actually went ahead and bought a car insurance before starting ACO, and I realized the journey was crazy broken. And we realized that yes, there is something really, really important to solve here, especially, I mean, not just for women, for everyone for sure, but for women more important, because like you rightly mentioned, it is, you know, something that we find very boring. You know, we are very happy, you know, cooking for ourselves, shopping, doing things which is more related to life. Financial planning, investments is not really, you know, something that brings us closer to life in that sense, and we find, you know, very hard to kind of do that. It comes easy for men probably because they are also very commercial minded or oriented in that sense. But you know, unless fintech, you know, and financial services start creating products, start actually you making the whole sort of consumer journey seamless, and kind of taking out the whole, you know, the shebang, the, you know, the heaviness that's attached to financial product, it's not going to happen. So with ACO, actually now we know that women find it easy to buy insurance because they can do it themselves. So, you know, while they're taking a break at work, they can open ACO.com, and it's an easy way to buy insurance. You don't have to really depend on a third party or a person to help you or handhold you to do it. And you know, I generally feel that it's about time. Women are out there, they're working, they're independent, they're making their own money. So, you know, it's about time that they start managing and taking control of their own money and bank accounts too. So, you know, to that extent, you know, how can we empower them so that they take interest? They find, for example, something which is today the biggest buzzword, stock trading, fun and, you know, easy to pick up, you know. So, you know, tech can actually help solve a lot of these things, you know. So, I think, yeah, so that's going to be very important, you know.
I think sometimes it takes a village to really make sense of what is going on. So, building a insurtech product and, you know, understanding insurance, and it's a tricky business at the end of the day. So, you know, kudos to you for actually going out and building one over there and helping a lot of more women to buy insurance as a product. So, Ms. Ramadevi Lanka, are you able to hear me now?
Yes, it's clear now. Thank you.
Yes. So, you know, what I was asking you earlier was that, you know, particularly now with your profile in the government and you're helping build the tech industry in Telangana, how do you see that we can have more women participating in the tech industry? You know, how can we have more women either doing more jobs in the tech industry or becoming largely, where my focus would be, is to become more tech entrepreneurs, you know, where they can be more sort of focused in building a tech company. Because today, you know, they understand technology, they understand the product, and they understand the market fit as well. So how can we encourage them to be more participative in building organizations?
Thank you for asking this question. Anything related to women is really close to my heart, you know. You may be aware that I am heading the Emerging Technologies Division, all new age technologies like, you know, we work on AI, ML, blockchain, cloud, robotics, you name it, the new technologies is what we actually are focusing in Telangana. And I mean, me heading itself is a big, you know, kind of, how should I put it, you know, the government consciously did that to make, so that women lead in our, you know, state in holding very important positions. Like I head the direct emerging technologies. Then we have, what you call, you know, B-Hub, Women Entrepreneurs Hub. I'm not sure if you have heard about this. It's again headed by Ms. Deepti. She's the CEO of, you know, B-Hub. So there are various initiatives, you know, that are very important initiatives that are headed by women. This sends out a message to all the, you know, young women out there, like, these are the kind of roles probably if we can aspire, you know, we can actually become like this. That's one thing. Second, in Telangana and more so in India as well, we have many women actually doing, studying technology, STEM and so on. While the number of people or women who are actually making it to jobs or entrepreneurship is quite less. So the first thing you have to address the root cause, right? First thing we need to do is increase this pool of women, you know, I talk about tech because I'm from the tech background. So increase this pool of women who are actually doing STEM courses or engineering courses or technology courses. So out of this pool, say you have some, you know, X percentage, out of this only Y percentage could make it to the tech jobs. And yesterday we had a beautiful panel discussions with women from blockchain, from who are leading, you know, blockchain companies, AI organizations, drones and so on, you know. So one important thing everybody echoed is the kind of jargon, you know, that or the terminologies in technology. If you take blockchain, we talk about crypto, smart contracts, those terms itself sort of, you know, acting as a deterrent to women, to young girls to take up actually tech oriented, you know, roles. So that's one thing probably awareness programs, you know, might help girls or young women to take up tech. That's number one. Second is, as you rightly pointed out, you know, how do we make more women become entrepreneurs? That's exactly the reason, you know, it's, I think in 2000, I'm not sure about the exact year, 2018 or something, you know, we had this global entrepreneur summit in Hyderabad. When Ms. Trump actually, Trump's daughter has actually, Ivanka Trump has visited Hyderabad. During that event, we actually announced that Telangana is going to set up an entrepreneurs hub, you know, incubator for women, you know. So that's what we did. And for the last 5-6 years, we have done a tremendous, you know, work on that. And today there are many young entrepreneurs. It's again not a tech incubator, while we have T-Hub. I'm not sure if you have heard about it. It's one of the largest incubator in India, you know, and largest innovation campus in Asia is what we call. That caters to both men and women, you know, while WeHub caters only to women entrepreneurs. So specific programs, funding, market access, mentorship are all actually, you know, designed for women entrepreneurs. But of course, WeHub is not a tech hub. It's actually kind of, you know, sector agnostic. So it's tech, you know, anybody, any other, you know, it could be a business as simple as, you know, selling diapers or just helping women entrepreneurs gain access to all these, you know, we call 6 M's in Telangana, money, mentorship, you know, markets and so on. So that's what we are doing right now. And hopefully, you know, such initiatives, if they are replicable in other states, that will actually lead more number of women, you know, taking up entrepreneurships. And one of the biggest challenge they face is to scale up, you know, okay, they start a small business, but they lack the skills and the resources to actually scale up. That's where again, our government is actually through WeHub or even our incubators, you know, we are actually helping them out.
Sure. Yeah. I think that's a great initiative, ma'am. And we've certainly heard of T-Hub, you know, they've done such great work in terms of putting entrepreneurs out there, helping the startups to accelerate their businesses. So I think great work that you're doing at WeHub as well as T-Hub over there in Telangana, and you know, thank you for helping women entrepreneurs to really find their mojo in the state and in the country, to get inspired by the work that you're doing. We also have Dr. Ekrup Kaur here with us. She's the secretary and from the Ministry of ITBT here in Karnataka. She was traveling, so she could not be here with us in person, but I think we have her online right now. Ma'am, can you hear us?
Yeah, I can hear you. A very good morning to all of you.
Thank you very much for joining us, ma'am. You know, we're not able to see you, but we understand that you're far away and, you know, it's hard to for you to join. But thank you for joining us. And, you know, we wanted to know if out here we're doing this event, Tech and Innovation Summit in Bangalore. And, you know, if any, there was a message for you that you wanted to give to women entrepreneurs and, you know, basically some ideas that you wanted to share on how to inspire them and how they could, you know, be more, we could have more tech, women tech founders here in Karnataka itself.
Yeah. So first of all, I would like to wish a very happy Women's Day to all the women who are present here. In fact, government of Karnataka has been consistently investing and seeing that, you know, women get that space which they absolutely deserve. And while, you know, all our programs usually focus at 30% of affirmative action in favor of women, 33%, but we do target to reach 50%, which is actually what is the rightful share of women. So in that direction, there are many programs which have been initiated, especially for women in tech as well, where we are, you know, reaching out and giving special support to women to join this entrepreneurial journey and to make it easy for them. One of our flagship programs of the department is Elevate. And in fact, in the initial years, we had run a separate, you know, vertical as Elevate Women, which was only meant for women-led entrepreneurs. But I must say, and I think it's a matter of pride for us, that though we have discontinued that program, it is only because we have seen that there are a lot of women-led startups. And even if we do a general call, we get almost equal number of male as well as female-led. Just a day before 8th March, which is on 7th evening, we had come up with the results of our Elevate program, where we fund up to 50 lakhs grant is given to startups for idea to POC stage. And out of the 102 winners, we had almost 32 women-led entrepreneurs who had qualified, and they will be getting the grant. Similarly, for women from, you know, the underprivileged sections, we have a special Elevate Unnati, where out of the 7 winners, 4 were women-led startups. So, which just goes to show that, you know, in some way, a beginning has been made, and without affirmative action also, women can actually compete and work on par with men. The other program that we do, and it's, I think, very significant in a way, is even though after starting, you have a startup, you come out with some tech solutions, some products, but marketing, finding linkages, and all of that is very difficult for especially women. So we have a special program which has been announced in this budget. It is actually, from the learnings of last couple of years that we have designed this program, where we will be connecting these startups with specific mentors, with specific VCs, and with specific market players to ensure that their journey beyond, the initial phase, beyond the early stage also, which is their growth stage of the startup, is also supported. So that program will also be launched in the coming financial year. And this is going to be only for women. Of course, we have some partners who are going to do this program with us. We have identified NGOs who are in the tech domain, working in different areas across Karnataka. It is not just Bangalore specific, but across Karnataka. And they will be, partnering with us to take this forward. Another program that we are doing, where again women are, you know, participating in large numbers, is market access across, overseas, market access to foreign countries. We have last year taken 4 such cohorts of 10 each. Each of the cohorts had participants, women-led startups also participating. And we connect them with global players. We connect them with launchpads in foreign countries, which help them build their markets abroad. So these are programs basically because I feel that, some kind of hand-holding support is still required. And women especially need that because many of them are first-time entrepreneurs. Many of them come from families which are, traditional. They don't have that kind of exposure earlier. But any woman who has shown the courage, who has shown the determination and perseverance to reach this level, we are certainly out there to help them and support them and see that their journey is successful in every which way.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for joining us here today and sharing those ideas. And I'm sure a lot of women are going to reach out to you for these programs that you have put in place for empowering women. Thank you for being here, and we wish you and Ma'am Rama Devi Lanka both a very, very happy Women's Day. And thank you for all the wonderful initiatives that you've both taken for women at large. Ma'am, Ma'am Rama Devi Lanka, any final message you want to give to women entrepreneurs out here, to build their startups?
Well, now, the scenario is totally different, unlike a decade ago. So, as Ms. Kaur has earlier mentioned, governments are actually coming forward to help women as much as possible. So this is the time, I think, right time for women to take up entrepreneurs, become entrepreneurs, whatever support that's required from the government is being provided. And for us in Telangana, we have a very good startup ecosystem in the state. So you have, mentors available. We are enabling even, venture capitalists, funding these startups. So it's one of the best times, I think, that to become an entrepreneur. So please, whoever have some doubts on this, just, dispel all those myths and doubts and just, come forward and become an entrepreneur. This is the best time, during our generation, for us, only one opportunity was there, after coming out of college. It was just jobs, nothing else, but this is a golden period, I would say, in India and across India and especially in Telangana. So please, take a decision, be bold and just step out there as an entrepreneur.
Sure. Yeah. Thank you very much, ma'am. Really appreciate your being here, and talking to all the women entrepreneurs here in the hall. Thank you very much. Dr. Ekrup Kaur, any final message for you for the women out here today who are looking to build their tech enterprises?
Our colleague from Telangana just mentioned, I think the time is just right. Entrepreneurship per se is, being given a big push, and women certainly will remain at the forefront of all initiatives. And I think now is the time to take plunge. And I was quite happy to see both of us from government also are women who are representing the tech sector. So that should give more encouragement and, that final push to our women that there are their own people, who are there in the government as well, will support them. I also would like to encourage women, and any support which is required, we are always accessible. You can reach out to us anytime, and we would see that we support you and we ensure that your journey is as smooth as possible.
Thank you very much, Rama Devi ma'am, Dr. Ekrup Kaur, for sparing your valuable time and talking to the women out here. We really appreciate it and wish you once again a very happy International Women's Day.
Thank you,
ma'am. Ruchi, continuing our talk forward, in women's journey, building a business or building a startup and then building a family, it probably happens at the same time, right? So there's always a bone of contention for us women to say that, should we focus more there? And, there's always a pull and push that keeps happening in our life constantly. So how do you sort of balance it? I think that's one thing all of us always need advice on, because, there is always this one thing in our mind which keeps on, you know, putting us in both the spaces at the same time. So how do you do it?
That's a very interesting question, because literally for me, the day I incorporated ACCO in 2016, my twins were born the same day. So I was signing the term sheet and literally rushing to the hospital. So you know what, I think first of all, we have to give some credit to the babies, the children. They are pretty resilient. You know, as mothers, we feel like they need you 24/7. They don't need you 24/7, I can assure you that much. And you know, like maybe initial years, you have that emotion, you have sort of those, you know, the guilt attached to not being there. But it works much better when you give your child an inspiration at home. That's very important. You have to create a role model, you know, while growing up. And you know, I always think about, like, really, like, what was it for me? And you know, today we discuss about, and there is, you know, this whole gap of women in technology, and why women don't take interest in technology is because there are no role models for them. You know, you can't look up to, when I was growing up, my role model was Steffi Graf, because in 90s, I grew up watching Wimbledon, French Open, this, that. And, you know, for me, I wanted to be like Steffi Graf. And then suddenly, one fine day, I heard about a lady called Kalpana Chawla. And I was like, oh my God, a woman can actually go to space. This is amazing. I mean, how is this even possible? But the fact is that anything is possible. You have to create that role model at home. You have to generate that interest. You know, so what happens is that, you know, the child automatically, and it has to start from the mother. So if the child doesn't see the mother actually stepping out and building something, it's not easy for the child to also imbibe an inspiration. So you have to do it. You have to, you owe it to your child as the mother. You can nurture the child at home, give all the love and care. But if you don't create that inspiration from yourself, trust me, you know, later on, you will regret. As the world's moving on, the child will actually derive maximum power from that, you know. So that's very important. You have to set aside your guilt. You have to, so now it comes down to, how do you really build an ecosystem of, you know, looking after a child? First of all, you know, you have to also give credit to your husbands. Men are really stepping up these days. You know, we live in a world where, you know, the roles are kind of merging together, you know. So it's a beautiful, it's an amazing world we are. Let's leverage on. You know, in most cases, so even I thought, maybe I'll have to take a backseat. Twins, how am I going to do it? And, you know, my God, I can't leave my child, you know, all of that. But let's just give it to the men as well. They are an amazing father and a parent. Okay, lean on them. Create a system at home where both of you can actually take turns, okay? And now you have an amazing system in India, first of all. I mean, you don't have any dearth of helps. And now you have an amazing system of daycare. So you have to really build this all together so that you have a support system that lets you not take that break. Because you're doing it for your child, okay? Your child needs that inspiration. And then you're doing it for yourself. You owe it to yourself. You know, a few years later, the child will be gone and you look back and think, oh, I, you know, worked so hard, I studied so hard, I got my degrees and I had an ambition and I gave it all up. So don't do this to yourself, and most importantly, don't do this to your child. Build an ecosystem. We are lucky we are in India, we can actually do it. Parents support, in-law support, you know, you just have to find that sweet spot. Okay, but that sort of leap of faith, the woman itself will have, herself will have to take it.
Have you ever sort of felt in the entrepreneurial world that the women somehow get shadowed, you know, either by the fact that, you know, there is some other male startup who's up there, you know, and your investors want to always make a comparison between their company and your company? Or do you feel that for, as a woman entrepreneur, it's hard to raise capital at times?
It is. I mean, that's the reality. That's the hard reality that it is. There are prejudices attached to, you know, being a woman founder. And some of these are, of course, whether you will continue with the business or not, what will happen if you decide to get married or have children, you know, because unfortunately, there is, you know, sort of examples of, you know, people kind of, you know, backing out after, you know, they had kids. So, you know, there is unfortunately prejudices that have come up because of that. I hope we can break that somehow. The VCs will also have to take a little more kinder step. I think they're doing that. They are trying to really, really, you know, come out there and be more supportive. I think it's, again, like I said, an amazing time. So women have to leverage this. Okay, if they have a great idea, I can assure you, everybody will take notice. Okay, it's nothing got to do with that idea, coming from a woman or a man. I don't think that matters. What matters is that it's a great idea. It's solving a big problem, or it's solving a problem that matters, and is impactful. So people will take notice. That for sure I can tell you, because let's also look at the reality of things. There are a lot of VCs in this country. There's a lot of money to be invested. Is there enough investment opportunities? No. So great businesses will find avenues. It's just that, we have to set the noise aside, first of all. We have to feel confident. I can tell you that when I started off, even I felt like, will they even listen to me? Like when I walk into a room, all these men, will they even like take me seriously? Forget that, yeah. Just get that appointment, go meet them. It'll happen. We have to first break that barrier in our head,
I think that's a great point. I'll also let some women entrepreneurs in this room to actually take some questions for you. So if there are some questions that women entrepreneurs would like to ask here, happy to pass on the mic to you over here. Would you? Okay, just a minute. I'm just giving it to you.
Hi, Tia. Hi. From Australia. I'm actually doing research right now on how capital flows into entrepreneurial ecosystems, and I'm specifically looking at diversity and linked impact. One of the things that I found in Australia, as well as here in India, is the way that investors make decisions. They say that the first thing that they look at is the founder itself. Now, research has shown that women entrepreneurs pitch and tell stories differently than men entrepreneurs. And even though venture capital say that they make a decision based purely on whether the business is a good idea or not, research shows that that's actually not true, that they have a lot of biases around that. So I'm just wondering, around your last point of being able to raise capital and that it was more difficult for you to raise capital as a woman, I'm wondering if you're aware of, A, if you have any specific advice aside from the advice that you just gave to women who are looking to raise capital, and B, if you're aware of any type of initiatives that are happening. There's a lot of things that are happening to increase the amount of women entrepreneurs, but I'm wondering if there's also the same amount of effort to increase female investors.
Sorry, I didn't get your first question.
One, if you have any more advice for female founders in learning how, in teaching them how to pitch to venture capital, and two, whether you're aware of any kind of initiatives that are increasing the other side of the pipeline, which is VCs that are woman-led.
On the first one, I think when it comes to pitching, honestly, you have to start from a plank that you're not pitching as a woman founder. You're pitching as a founder. You're a founder. It doesn't matter if you're a man or a woman. Okay. So don't enter the room thinking, oh, I'm a woman founder. I'm going in as that. So my pitch has to be any different. It's an idea. It's a business. It's a passion that you have. So you're building for that. Okay. So you have to really start from that. Trust me, once you actually, remove that from your head, like, somehow it never occurred to me, because way back in 2015-16, the discourse around women founder not being able to raise was far and few, because there weren't many, to be honest. And during my journey also as a VC, I worked at Matrix Partners, I didn't really see a lot of women founders come up to pitch, and those who came up, a lot of them did get funded, So to me, I feel that, this is kind of a misconception in our head that we don't get funded because we are women founder. Okay. There is some prejudices for sure. Like I said, they have these doubts in their head and they probably have these questions, because ultimately, let's face it, they're putting in money. It's money at stake. Someone else's money, not even their money, So they have a fiduciary responsibility to ensure that that money is going in the right hand. So probably it's coming from that place and not from a, place or a stereotype of trying to fund a woman founder. So enter the room as a founder, don't enter the room thinking. I've sat in, investment committee decisions where women founder have presented. I don't think there has been any judgment or a behavior where I felt that, she's being kind of like, treated differently because she's a woman founder. Women founders have been funded. They've been funded because they've had a great pitch. They have a great idea. There is, of course, a plan and a lot of those things which a typical investor will look at. So don't worry about it. There are a lot of investors today. Okay, go in there as a founder with your idea and what you're trying to build and what is it in it for them, you know. So that's, that to me is very important. There is, of course, on the second point, since I raised funds for ACCO and now a lot of new women VCs have, you know, come up. In fact, somebody messaged me the other day, I'll tell you, just 1 second. Yeah, so another woman-focused VC fund called, sorry, I'm not wearing my glasses, so hard to read. Called Colossa Ventures raised their maiden fund. So a lot of them are coming up. It's not like, you know, they, I mean, is there a men-focused VC fund? No. Is there any VC fund that says, oh, we are, you know, quote-unquote male-focused VC fund. We only fund male. But let's, like, you know, enjoy the moment that there is so much, like, a lot of them now. You know, so it's a great time for us, and there are a lot of women support group communities that have come up together of women entrepreneurs. I'm part of a few, and I'm trying to also get more women join so that we can also be there for each other. What we need is that solidarity more than anything else, and also to learn from each other. Like the recent event that I hosted for women founders, you know, we get to discuss about how to handle growth, for example. You know, you're building a product, how do you look at distribution, for example. A lot of these things, when you share experiences and talk about it, help. So today, I think it's a great time. We have to just find those opportunities. Look at and build those connects. All the women VCs that I know, great, yeah, they are always reaching out with something or the other. Hey, have you looked at this? Have you tried that? I'm building something new now in fashion. So, you know, there is always information flow. You just have to connect yourself. You know, very important.
So I've already been told about the time thing, but thank you so much, Ruchi, for joining us. And, you know, you're building, you built such a wonderful company here at ACCO, and, you know, to be able to, as you said, twins. In fact, you know, one of our third speakers who was to join us had a similar emergency today. So she was on the way and she had to rush to the hospital for her pregnancy. So, yeah, that's the way it is for us sometimes. And, you know, we learn to live with it and we learn to grow our businesses with it. So thank you very much for joining us once again. Pleasure having you here and talking.